The workplace landscape has been in constant flux. Now, more than ever, there is an evolution in the way things are getting done. And concepts like artificial intelligence, digital native, and the gig economy can no longer be ignored. With the digital revolution upon us, are our jobs safe? And how do companies secure themselves moving forward? I had a chat with entrepreneur, angel investor, and keynote speaker Malik Parekh about his new book, Future Proof Your Career and Company, which addresses all of these trends and more. And here's that interview. You wear many hats. You're an entrepreneur, you're an angel investor, and now all of a sudden you are also an author. Did you see this in the cards for you? And what exactly inspired you to come out with this book?
Yeah, well, you know, a lot of people have asked me this question as I start sharing that this book is coming out. And there are two main reasons. One is a professional reason and the other is a personal reason. Professionally, you know, when I was a CEO of Inspiro, and I was a CEO for Inspiro until March of this year, for the last 3 years, I noticed that there were three very powerful and disruptive forces were at play. I noticed that the artificial intelligence was slowly sneaking into our workplaces, in our jobs, in our companies. I noticed that the digital natives were storming the workplace and they were turning it upside down. In fact, in the previous 3 years, 100% of the people that we hired were either millennials or Gen Z. And they are a different breed altogether. And the third thing I noticed is that the gig economy is becoming very popular and is changing how people are working, but also where they are working from and for who they are working for. So it's a huge change that is taking place in the business world today. And I noticed it firsthand as part of my job. Personally, something else happened in my life. I was just talking to you, Lexi, earlier. My first daughter was born 4 years ago, and that changed everything for me. You know, I turned 46. And I realized that the future is more meaningful for me. And I had to start thinking more about what kind of future my daughter is going to have when she grows up. So I started paying more attention to where the trends are going in the future. What are some of the things that she will grow up with? What are some of the challenges and opportunities that she will face when she's in her 20s and 30s?
So you talked about AI, you talked about digital natives, and you also did mention the gig economy. Now, why do you feel that these three are part of the whole disruption of the last decade in terms of work, in terms of the way careers are going, in terms of the way companies have to rethink or reshape the way they hire people?
Sure. You know, one of the reasons I wanted to write this book is because I felt that during this COVID-19 crisis, everybody is so focused on COVID, and rightfully so. It's obviously changing everybody's life, whether you are a business or a person or an employee. But people are not paying attention to the three forces that are disrupting the world as we speak. And while the COVID-19 is going to one day disappear and fade away, and hopefully soon, these three forces are going to continue gaining momentum. They're going to continue gaining speed. They're going to gain strength as we go forward. So I thought it's important to take a step back and focus our energy and effort on some of the long-term trends that may impact our companies and our careers in the next 10 years. So the reason I thought AI, digital natives, and the gig economy are the most important forces at play is because they all are born out of the digital revolution. They all are actually siblings. You know, why are digital natives so different than the rest of the generations? Because of their ability to work with digital platforms better than any other generation. So if you look at the trend of where the digital revolution is going, it's about to peak in the next 10 years. And as it peaks, all these three forces are also going to peak at the same time. And so if you're a business leader, what's the weather forecast for you, for your business? It's a perfect storm because all of these things are all going to happen at the same time. And you need to be prepared for it.
Well, when you call them forces, this isn't necessarily a negative thing because they can also be positive forces if you understand them. And I guess use them wisely because, like, let's say when we talk about AI, it's really intimidating. It's something that is yet very unknown. And the only thing that we can think of is, one day, do you feel that all of this artificial intelligence will take over the jobs that a lot of us have now?
That's right, yeah. Well, you know, and I get that question quite a bit now. Will AI take my job? And I think there has been a lot of study that has gone in. So, you know, institutions like McKinsey and Oxford University and the Brookings Institution, they all have done studies about whether AI will take over the jobs. And while they use a different approach and they all came to a different conclusion, at the end of the day, what they realized was a very common sense insight. And the common sense insight can be broken down into three different parts. The first part is, if your job can be broken down into what is repetitive, what is boring, what is predictable, then AI can do that job. So you should be worried. So if you are flipping burgers, for example, if you are checking in guests at the hotel, if you are answering basic customer queries at a call center, then you should be worried about your job. The second thing they found as part of the insight was that if anything you do has a very defined objective and you can feed the AI algorithm with a loads of historical data, then AI can do your job. So I don't know whether you caught this or not, but earlier this year, Google AI actually became better at reading mammograms than the trained human professionals. And the way they did that was they basically fed the AI algorithm with a lot of historical data about how the mammograms were read by the humans in the past. And AI was able to pick up how to find the right tumor. And it gives you less number of false positives and less numbers of false negatives compared to the humans. So you have to keep in mind that if AI can be trained with a historical data and it has a very well-defined target, then AI can do that job as well.
Well, the digital native is another animal on its own. You know, we've got millennials who are part of it and Gen Z as well. Not only do they see the world differently, they're very tech savvy, but they also have a different way of viewing work and long-term work at that. So maybe you can also sort of match them up with the gig economy, because, you know, with the millennials, there was a study made by JobStreet that said that they really are about wanting to have a good life.
That's right.
But it also is about having work, but that work will give them that good life. Like, let's say if they want to take a year off to be in a beach somewhere, they're going to do it.
That's right.
So I'm not saying they're unpredictable in that sense and unreliable, but this is the way that things have shifted in terms of HR practices as well.
Absolutely. And, you know, you mentioned digital natives. When you think of the digital natives, we think of young and scrappy, headphone wearing, soya latte drinking, avocado toast eating youngsters. We don't think of them as the executives and the leaders of a company. But one thing I came across while doing the research is that by 2030, 2/3 of the global workforce will be made up of these digital natives, millennials or Gen Zers. And the 2030 would be the last year when the last batch of baby boomers will reach the retirement age of 65. So the world at the workplace would be significantly different than what we have noticed in the past. We are used to seeing these youngsters as an intern or as an entry-level employee, but very soon they're going to be in the leadership position. And it's very important for us to understand who they are, how they operate, and what motivates them.
Exactly. And how can these companies, because if they are going to be the leaders of these companies, you need them to want to stay.
Exactly.
And make the commitment to be able to lead these companies.
Absolutely. And it's becoming very hard because, as I mentioned to you earlier, these digital natives are a different breed for three key reasons. Number one, they are used to working with the latest technology. I mean, if you look at their lives, what you notice is that every 2 years they have seen the smartphone upgrading. Every year they have seen the Siri and Alexa getting better. Every year they see the internet speed connectivity getting better, even though sometimes we are not feeling nowadays. But they have only seen the world getting better, faster, and smarter. So that is the way they look at the world. So if they're working for a company, they're going to expect to have the latest and the greatest technology. The second thing that differentiates them is that they are very entrepreneurial. They are the group of people who have seen their young cohorts basically starting a business, freelancing business with just a smartphone and an internet connectivity. They have seen their own peers becoming YouTube or TikTok sensations by using a smartphone and internet connectivity. So they know that with the technology, they can start their own business. In fact, there was a study done, let's see, recently. They asked the high schoolers, would you like to start your own business or would you like to work for somebody else? 71% of these youngsters said they would like to start their own business.
Exactly. And this is where the gig economy comes in as well, because you've got all of these freelancers who, yes, can work for companies, but maybe on a consultation basis, because they also have an idea of how they want to live and how they want to work. They want their own time. They want to be flexible. So how do you put that into companies that have had age-old systems in place and maybe are not willing to adapt just yet? Do they have to? Are we getting there?
No, I think that's a big challenge for the companies now. There are two key challenges when it comes to attracting the freelancers, right? Number one, companies need to have a structure, because if you look at the companies nowadays, they are used to managing, leading, attracting and retaining employees who come to work every day in their own offices. They're not used to remote workers who are not even their employees. So how do you create a forum, a framework where even the full-time employees as well as the freelancers can work together and work together cohesively? So that's one challenge. And the other challenge, Lexi, is your existing employees are going to look at their friends who are starting out and becoming a freelancer, and they're going to ask themselves, like, why should I continue working for this company if I can also become a freelancer? So companies will have to create a culture which allows the people the freedom and flexibility. It creates what I call in the book entrepreneurial culture, where you are an employee for the company, but the company allows you to create and manifest your ideas. And if you can do those two things, then I think companies would be in a better shape to continue progressing and thriving in this the gig economy.
Well, let's go back to your book. It's called Future Proof Your Career and Your Company. So we pretty much went through the first part, which is talking about AI, digital natives, and the gig economy. But it sounds like a not self-help book, but it sounds like something that is giving a lot of topics to, or, you know, bullet point exactly what you need to do. But you do it in prose form. That's the interesting part about this book. What made you decide to do something like this as opposed to a book that just really spells it out for people?
I have purposefully kept the sentences, the words, very simple, but yet it goes to the heart of the matter. And I have had a bunch of people who have read advanced copies of this book, and they all basically came back with the one feedback that this was an easy book to read. It was written in a conversational tone. It was written as if I'm talking to the readers. Because at the end of the day, what is the purpose of writing a book? Hopefully that people would read the book. And that is what I've done.
Exactly. So we have gone through the first part, not necessarily first chapter, but then the next one is about future-proofing careers, because you're talking not only to companies, but you're talking to individuals, because you have a lot of people concerned that maybe AI will be taking over their jobs, as we spoke about before, or maybe that you've got boomers and Gen Xers who are still very much wanting to be part of the workforce, but the digital natives have sort of also taken over and they need to adjust as well. So what are the five things that you can do to future-proof? First, let's talk about the career.
Well, to future-proof your career, Lexi, you have to have a perspective of what the future would be like. And I have laid out five different types of futures that we can expect going forward. So the number one for your career is that the future is artificial intelligence. It's only going to continue increase its presence in your companies, in your jobs. So when the artificial intelligence is going to increase its presence, what do? You become the human that the AI cannot replicate. You have to cultivate the human qualities. You have to cultivate your EQ, more empathy, more malasakit, as you will say it here in the Philippines. You will have to enhance your creativity. You will have to create more inspiring presence where you are able to convince people and influence people through your inspiring leadership. If you can do some of these things, which only humans can do, you cannot have an AI do that, then you'll succeed in your future. So that's number one, that AI is, the future is AI. And the best way to have a better career going forward is to become a better human. That's kind of a unique thing to say, but it's true. The second thing we have to do as a human being in terms of your career is future is going to be full of changes. And in order for you to succeed in this environment where there are a lot of changes taking place, not only you have to accept these changes, but what I'm suggesting in the book is that you have to become a catalyst for a change. You have to cultivate the muscles to say no more to nonsensical, to unfair, to things that don't make sense to you anymore. And become the champion of positive changes and create value for the companies. If you become the catalyst, then the companies are going to look for people like you who are going to drive the change and make it happen for them. Then the third thing people need to know that future is people. Even though technology is going to take a bigger role in our lives, people are not going anywhere. And if you want to make a presence felt in your company, you have to be a better leader. You have to be an alchemist who can take ordinary people and can make them do extraordinary things. If you can do that as part of your job, then your career will continue to succeed. The fourth thing I tell people is that future is turbulent. There are a lot of changes that are going to happen. You know, you will see companies and jobs becoming irrelevant. You will see industries becoming obsolete. At that time, you need people who are able to actually have a poise, have clarity, have a nerves of steel while this turbulence is going on around them. So future is turbulent, and you have to be a captain, as if you are taking a ship through a perfect storm, or you are flying a plane through a turbulent weather ahead. And the fifth thing you need to understand is that future is unknown. You know, we don't know what the future is. So the best way you can approach something that is unknown is to research, to become a futurist. And the best way to do become a futurist is look at all the clues that you have around you as to where the future is going. Study those clues, synthesize them, and extrapolate them, and have a view as to where the future is going. So if you do these five things, if you become a better human, if you become a better catalyst, if you become an alchemist, if you become a captain, and if you become a futurist in your job, then you're going to have a very strong career progression ahead.
And I'm sure for companies, because we don't have much time left, but for companies, it's pretty much the same thing, only expanded. Maybe you can just enumerate what the five ways to future-proof a company is.
Sure. So for the companies, the future is digital. So they must transform their business to lead, to disrupt versus being disrupted. So that's number one. The second thing for the company is that the future is meaningful, and the companies will have a very strong purpose, will do well compared to the others who don't have a very strong purpose, that would not be able to inspire people to join them and take them to the next level. The third thing the companies would need to understand is that the future is boundless. There are many more opportunities. And in order to take advantage of these opportunities, you have to unleash innovation. And the fourth thing companies would need to do is that future is new. There are a lot of new things that you would need to learn. So you'll have to inspire learning within your organization. And then the fifth thing for the company is that future is fun. Even though the journey ahead is going to be very difficult, it's going to be arduous, it's up to the company and it's up to the leaders to make sure that the employees are going to have a good time. They're going to have a journey of a lifetime versus the Monday to Friday nightmare that people always complain about.
Well, I think everyone has, you know, decided to, especially with COVID, because it is also very relevant that everyone, the buzzword of COVID seems to be pivot, because yeah. Now things are going to be a new normal. We can't expect things to be exactly the same as we left it pre-COVID. And all of these points about future-proofing the career and the company as well. I think it is very much about that. It's about pivoting towards more technology or pivoting towards just opening up, because there are so many new things that are coming in, and you can't have that old normal. Am I correct?
Absolutely. So you have to look beyond the COVID-19. It will go away. You have to prepare your company for the other forces that are going to only gain strength, gain speed, gain momentum going forward.
And so today, if I'm not mistaken, October 17th is your day for pre-order for the book.
That's right.
And you have this wonderful advocacy that, along with the book, you're going to launch an advocacy called Book to the Future. Maybe you can talk to us about that as well.
Sure. So, something that is near and dear to our heart, my wife Tanisha and myself, is helping street children get basic education. And we realize that there are 284 million kids around the world who are not even getting that basic education. So we want to do our part, one child at a time. So we have partnered with two charities, one in the Philippines. It's called Pangarap Foundation, and the one in India, which is the Hope Foundation. And 10% of the profit coming from this book sales would all go towards these two charities to help them better educate the kids on the street.
All right, that's a beautiful thing to do as well. So not only are you educating those who will be buying your book, talking about how to future-proof, it's also about giving back, because in the end, it's all an education for everybody, because we're all relearning all of these things as well. So maybe, Malik, just final words for those who want to purchase the book, and for those who maybe are watching and feel that finally their company is in for a change, or maybe someone is rediscovering that there's a new career path for them.
Absolutely. Well, I have put my heart and soul into this book for the last few months, and I can assure you that people would gain a lot of insights about how to improve their career and company. As you mentioned, Lexi, thank you. The book is available for pre-order starting today. They can send us an email if they want to directly purchase it from us at info@maulikparekh.com. And we'll be sharing some information about where the books will be available here in the Philippines. We are partnered with ABS-CBN Books. So there will be some bookstores in Manila and other cities that will be selling this book. And those of you with Amazon account, they can also pre-order the book directly on Amazon starting today.
All right. Well, Malik Parekh, thank you so much for joining me, the author of Future Proof Your Career and Company. All the best to you. And for now, do stay safe.
Thank you so much, Lexi. Thanks for having me.